Hi everyone, welcome to today's webinar session on introduction to the project management professional certification, or better known as the PMP certification offered by Project Management Institute. So this webinar session is intended for individuals who are interested in a profession of project management, or individuals who are already in a project management role who are interested in obtaining a certification related to project management. So this webinar session will give an introduction to the different certifications offered by PMI, and then specifically we'll be talking about the PMP certification offered by them. So first of all, a brief introduction about myself. I'm Ramesh Vijayathunga. I'm an IT professional from Sri Lanka with over 13 years of experience in the industry. I'm currently the Chief Innovation Officer of Size Limited, UK-based IT services delivery company, where I'm heading the operations in the development arm in Sri Lanka. I'm also the Director Chief Operating Officer of LearnTin, a global training provider, where we are focusing on certifications and corporate training on business analysis project management. And then I'm also Director Co-Founder of Seribo Consulting, which is also a consultancy firm, a startup related to business analysis and project management, where we help organizations in defining their project management office, PMO, and the BA Center of Excellence, and then help them defining the processes and then executing those processes in their organizations. I'm also a certified project manager, business analyst, and agile professional. So I've done certifications offered by PMI, Scrum Alliance, and IIBA, and then from Axelos as well. I'm also a visiting lecturer and trainer at multiple private universities here in Sri Lanka, where I do lectures on IT project management, business consulting, and general management subjects for BSc and MSc level students. So let's look at today's outline for the session. First of all, we'll be looking at what PMI is, Project Management Institute is, and then we'll be looking at the different certifications offered by PMI. And then we'll be talking about the PMP certification in detail, and we'll look at the requirements that you need to fulfill in order to apply for the PMP certification, and then to sit for that exam. And then we'll be talking about the different investments you need to make in terms of time and cost related to applying for the exam, preparing, and then doing the certification. And we'll be talking about the exam itself. We'll be talking about the type of questions that you can expect to see at the exam. And then we'll see a high-level distribution of questions from different process group areas defined in PMBOK. And then we'll look at how you should prepare for the exam, some tips and tricks that you can use when you are preparing for PMP. And then we'll look at the live virtual classroom sessions offered by Knowledgehut, how it operates, and how you can join and participate in those sessions. First of all, let's look at what PMI is. So PMI is the globally recognized standards organization or the association for the profession of project management. You can get more details about Project Management Institute by going into www.pmi.org. PMI was founded in 1969 and it is headquartered in New York, USA. PMI is a non-for-profit organization, and at the moment there are 2.9 million members who have registered as members of PMI. From over 170 countries. So this is an extra benefit that is offered by PMI, where people who are interested in the profession can go to PMI.org and then provide your details and get the membership from PMI. By getting the membership, you will get access to different materials, the PMBOK itself, access to webinars and other articles and stuff which are conducted or contributed by different PMP professionals from around the world, from the PMI.org site. And PMI is also the leading membership association, like I said, for the PM project management profession. And it provides global thought leadership, collaboration, education and training, and certifications related to project management, program management, portfolio management, and so on. At the moment, there are over 700,000 certified PMP professionals from around the world. So that's how popular PMI and its credentials are. So let's quickly look at the main type of certifications offered by PMI. So the first certification is Project Management Professional, PMP. So a person who has obtained the PMP professional would have gone through the PMBOK, would have gone through the different knowledge areas and process groups defined in the PMBOK, and the person with this credential is recognized as a person who understands the concepts and is able to apply concepts related to project management into his day-to-day operations as a project manager. And this Certified Associate in Project Management, or the CAPM certification, is a certification that people who have lesser amount of experience, who are new to the profession of project management, can think about doing. So a person certified as CAPM, again, would have thorough understanding about the basic concepts of project management, the different knowledge groups, knowledge areas, and then tasks, tools, and activities that a project manager can use and perform in his day-to-day life. So all those aspects of project management would be obtained by a person who has got this credential of CAPM. So the definition of project management says that a project is a unique endeavor undertaken in order to achieve a specific product, service, or a result. So a group of projects which are related together, where the person who is person or the organization who is performing the set of projects can gain a much higher benefit by doing those projects together, is called a program. So managing these interrelated programs itself is another capability that a project manager, a senior project manager, would have. So for these project managers, for these senior project managers, they can think about doing this program management professional certification. So this program management professional certification will give the professionals a better understanding about programs, how the projects within those programs are interrelated, and how to better manage those programs in order to get a cohesive or a higher benefit by doing those projects together. And the highest level of certifications that is offered by PMI is the Portfolio Management Professional, or the PFMP certification. So a portfolio is a combination of projects and programs which again are interrelated, and a portfolio manager would need to think about all these projects and programs which are carried out by an organization by looking at those projects from a holistic view. He would need to have a bird's eye view and get an understanding about the entire organization, how all these projects and programs are interrelated, and how these projects would be beneficial for the organization which is implementing them. So for those professionals, they can think about doing this Portfolio Management Professional certification. And PMI has ventured into other areas as well. So PMI has ventured into business analysis. So, and PMI offers the PMI Professional in Business Analysis certification. So PMI has understood that project manager alone cannot manage the project properly. And one of the main criteria for project success is to make sure that the scope and the requirements of the project is understood, that the communication among all the stakeholders who provide these requirements happens properly, and the coordination between the business team and the development team happens in a proper manner. In order to do this, this role of business analysis has been understood as one of the major roles for which PMI has defined this PMI PBA certification. And then the next certification offered by PMI is the PMI Agile Certified Practitioner certification. So Agile, if we take Agile itself has more than 10 different flavors. For example, XP, Kanban, Lean, Scrum, DSDM, pair programming, and all these different flavors of Agile are taught in this ACP certification, where the individual who is going through this particular certification will need to understand the concepts, the values, the principles and processes which are defined in the Agile manifesto, and then understand how these concepts can be applied to change-driven projects in organizations. So by doing the PMI ACP certification, the person would get a better understanding on how to manage, how to plan for, and how to manage the Agile project. PMI also specifically focuses on two main areas of project management. One is the risk management, and then the other one is schedule management. So every project is a temporary endeavor, plus there's uncertainty involved in all these projects. So undertaking a project involves risk, and managing this risk is one of the major important aspects that a project manager should be able to perform. So understanding the uncertainties that are involved in a project, understanding the threats or opportunities that these uncertain events can have in a project, and then how to increase the probability or the impact of these positive or negative risks are being taught in this risk management professional certification. So the last certification offered by PMI is PMI scheduling professional. So a project is a temporary endeavor, and it will have a defined timeline. So through scheduling management, a project manager should be able to understand the different work products or activities that needs to be performed in a certain project, understand the different resources that are required, understand the effort or time that is required in order to perform those activities, and based on that, come up with a schedule in order to deliver the project objectives. So all those aspects would be taught and learned by a professional who is going through this PMI scheduling professional certification. So this is a high-level understanding of the different certifications offered by PMI. So now let's look at what this PMP certification is. PMP is the most recognized and sought-after certification for the project management profession in the world today. And having this PMP certification, PMP credential following your name, tells the current and potential employers that you have demonstrated the solid foundation of understanding about the different concepts, tools and techniques that are applicable for the project management profession. Quick look at the criteria that you need to fulfill in order to apply for this PMP certification. So if you do not have a degree, if you only have a diploma or a secondary degree, and if you have more than 7,500 hours of project management experience, or in other words, 5 years of project management experience, then you can apply for the PMP certification. So this 5 years of experience in project management must be obtained within the last 8 years. So this is important to be kept in mind, because when you are documenting the requirements, when you're documenting your criteria or your eligibility criteria in application, you need to make sure that you cover 5 years of experience if you don't have a degree. And in addition to that, you need to have 35 contact hours of project management training. The second method is, if you have a degree or something higher, and if you have more than 4,500 hours of experience, or in other words, minimum of 3 years of experience, then again you can think about applying for the PMP certification. So this 3 years of experience again must be obtained within the last 8 years, and again you need to satisfy by obtaining 35 contact hours of classroom training. So what counts as 35 contact hours? So it's important to have an understanding of that as well. So we call this professional development units, or PDUs. So you can obtain professional development units in multiple ways. One way is to attend classroom sessions. So it can be a physical classroom session or an online virtual classroom session. So but what is important to note is that all these online classrooms, online or physical classroom sessions must be moderated or facilitated by someone who is going through materials created by following the PMBOK. So anyone who is doing the presentation, who is doing the training, must have created those materials based on what the concepts covering the project management body of knowledge. So make sure that you attend session in order to obtain your PDUs. And if you attend a webinar or if you attend a presentation or a PowerPoint presentation facilitated by someone, or if you follow some videos on YouTube which are not directly linked to the PMBOK, there will not be any point in documenting that as training hours in project management. So make sure that you follow the guidelines that I just mentioned above. Why this is important is that why Project Management Institute mandates this is because Project Management Institute wants to validate whether the participant has had the opportunity to interact with someone, interact with a moderator, ask questions, clarify doubts, and then only obtain the knowledge that is required in project management. So that is why that interaction or the facilitator is required. So let's look at direct investment that needs to be made in order to apply for this PMP credential. The first thing that you need to do when applying for this exam is to obtain the PMI membership. So I mentioned about obtaining the PMI membership and then the benefits that you will gain by obtaining it. So you can go to PMI.org website and then fill in the application form and then make a payment for $139 and then get the membership from PMI. So the benefit of having this PMI membership is that when you are applying for the exam or when you have to renew your credential, the payment that you need to make will be lesser. So for PMI members, the examination fee would only be $405 for the computer-based test, we call it a CBT, and the paper-based test would be $250. But if you are not a member of PMI, the CBT test cost examination fee would be $555, which is $150 more, and then more than that for PMI member, and then for the PBT exam, it would be $400. So you would see that there's a slight benefit if you get the PMI membership fee in terms of examination fee, as well as the other benefits that I mentioned to you earlier. So re-examination is something that you would need to do if you do not renew your credential. So I will talk to you about the renewal process in one of the upcoming slides, but just remember, you need to renew your credential or you need to show ongoing progress of maintaining your credential every 3 years. And if you don't renew your credential after the 3 year time period, you will get a grace period of 1 year before your credential is suspended. So if you fail to renew your credential within that time period also, you will need to resit for the exam. And that again would have a cost involved. So for the CBT exam again, $275, for the PBT, $150 for PMI members, and for non-members it would be $375 and $300 respectively. And credential renewal needs to happen every 3 years, as I mentioned. You need to report PDUs on an ongoing basis and then make the credential renewal fee to PMI. So for members, it's $60 only, but for non-members, the credential renewal would be $150. So this PMI membership needs to be renewed annually. So if you make sure that you renew your PMI membership and maintain that PMI membership, you would get the chance to get the benefits of lesser examination and other related fees. So in addition to these direct costs, there would be some indirect costs that are involved as well. In order to earn your PDUs, you can attend classroom sessions, as I mentioned earlier. So normally these classroom sessions, whether it's online or offline physical classrooms, classroom sessions, it would normally be of 5 to 7 or 8 days of duration, and the cost may range from $200 to $3,000. So if you don't have any certification training programs in your country or in your region, there might be some traveling involved as well. So that would involve an additional cost for you. So in addition to attending classroom sessions, you also should ideally get a study pack or get a examination preparation guide, read through the PMBOK guide as well as this exam preparation guide, and that would also involve a cost roughly about $50 to $300, and you need to practice as many questions as possible when preparing for the exam. And this again, you can obtain this from many vendors, online vendors, and this would again involve a cost of $50 to $300 or above. So the PMP exam is of 4 hours duration. Normally, this is a really tough time period for anyone. I myself did the PBT exam, where about 200 other aspirants sat for the exam at the same time. So roughly, you need to be at the examination center at least 30 minutes before the exam. There would be a stringent security checking process that is involved. So when you're going for the exam, make sure that you take your identification card. So if your identification card is not in English, make sure that you take your passport or any identification which is in English. You cannot take any materials or even a water bottle inside the examination center. You need to keep all your belongings outside when you enter the hall. And similarly, a CT exam also would be something like that, where you would need to be there early at the examination center, and the security checking and the process will involve in a CBT exam as well. You would get time to prepare. In a CBT exam, you would be given a notepad and a eraser and a marker where you can note down whatever concepts that you want to use in your exam. And in the PBT as well, you get a rough paper where you can write down whatever equations or concepts that you want to remember. And so the CBT online examination, you just need to use a tool and mark the answers online on the system itself, and you would know whether you have passed or failed the exam at the end of time period, the 4 hour time period. But in a PBT exam, you would need to mark your answers on a paper where the answer sheet will be collected, and you would only get to know the results after a two or three week time period. The exam would involve 200 multiple choice questions. Most of these questions are case study based questions. So they are testing the concepts of project management, but most of the time it is not directly. You would get a scenario based on which you need to select which concept or which theory or tool that they're talking about. So there'll be only one correct answer per question. There's no negative marking, so make sure that you answer all the questions. 25 out of the 200 questions in the exam are pre-released. What this means is that PMI normally includes 25 questions where they want to test out the validity or the appropriateness of those questions for upcoming examination sessions. So these 25 questions will not carry any marks. So even if you get them wrong, there's no problem. But these questions would be randomly placed within the examination paper. You would not know which one of the 200 questions is a pre-released question. So you would need to make sure that you answer all those questions, regardless whether it's a pre-released or a live question. So there will be 175 live questions in an exam. The pass mark roughly is about 63%. So that's about 107 to 100 questions that needs to be marked correctly. But this again depends on the examination that you take. You can get to know more details about the closest computer-based examination centers within your region by going into prometric.com website. So you need to apply for the exam. If you are sitting for a CBT online exam, you need to go to prometric.com and then make a booking for the exam. So let's quickly look at the examination process and then the credential renewal process as well. So everything related to the PMP credential is provided in the PMP credential handbook, which can be downloaded from the PMI website. And the application form and the application process also is online, and everything happens by going to PMI.org. The handbook itself, we will give you guidance on how to fill your application and then how to go through the application process as well. So once you start the application process, once you start filling the application form, you have 90 days in order to complete that application form. So the application form will have sections where you need to fill out basic details about yourself, your education, your work experience, the projects that you have done, and then how the tasks that you have performed in those projects are related to the different concepts or activities that are defined in the PMBOK. So everything needs to be properly documented in the application form that you fill. So this process of filling the application form itself will take a good 2 to 3 months time period. So once you have started filling the application form, make sure that you fill it within the 3 month time period, within the 3 month deadline. And once you submit it, PMI will take roughly about 5 days in order to review whether the application form that you have filled is complete or not. So once you have submitted the application form, once it is reviewed and confirmed, you will need to make the relevant payment, the examination fee payment, in order to schedule your exam. So you cannot schedule your exam until you make this particular payment. And then there's another alternative process that would go hand in hand in this with this main process as well, which is where a case where you will get audited. So there's a roughly 1 in a billion chance of your application for the PMP credential getting audited. So what this means is that when you're filling the application form, you first of all need to give details of 2 referees, maybe a career manager, maybe a project manager, to whom you have reported to in the past and whom you have quoted as a referee who can vouch for you. So if you get audited, your referees will get an email saying that this person has applied for the PMP credential, his application form is this, and it has got audited. So you roughly have 5 to 7 days, first of all, to fill in the details that you need to provide as supporting material for this audit process, as well as get your referees to fill in that form as well, which is given by the PMI. So once this audit materials are provided to PMI, once it is verified and once your application is approved again, then you can schedule your exam, CBT or PBT, and then sit for the exam. So once you make the payment, you have a 1 year time period during which you can sit for the exam 3 times. So don't worry if you could not get through the PMP examination in your first try. You will have 2 more attempts to sit for the exam and hopefully get through the exam. So once you pass the examination, your recertification cycle begins. You have a 3 year time period during which you need to obtain 60 professional development units or 60 PDUs. So reporting these PDUs itself is a different process. You can obtain more about this credential renewal process again from PMI.org, and the CCR process is well defined. The different categories based on which you can report your PDUs are also well defined in PMI. So make sure that you follow the guidelines and make sure that you report 60 PDUs in order to maintain your credential on an ongoing basis. Once you make the payment and once you report the 60 PDUs, your PMP credential will be valid for another 3-year time period. If in case you fail to renew your credential, first of all, after the 3-year time period, there will be a 1-year suspension period. So you have another 1-year time period during which you can satisfy the requirements. So for example, within the 3-year time period, you might have only obtained 50 PDUs. Don't worry. Again, you have another 1-year time period in order to obtain the remaining 10 PDUs that you require. Once you get those 60 PDUs again, make sure that you apply within this suspension period and renew your credential. If you fail to renew your credential within this 4-year time period, your credential will get expired and you will need to resit for the exam. So there will be a recertification fee, as I mentioned earlier, that will be applied. So this is a bit about the process that is involved with the PMP examination as well as the process involved in maintaining your credential. There will be 4 main questions that you can expect in the PMP examination. The first type is directly based on the definitions from the PMBOK. So you might see questions such as the model that depicts project roles and responsibilities is, where you will get 4 answers and you need to select the answer which directly matches with this particular question. So it's directly based on definitions from the PMBOK. There can be questions based on sequences of tasks as well. So there'll be questions like the first task that would be performed in terms of identifying project scope is, and you would need to select the answer that is correct. And there will be scenario-based questions where you will be given a paragraph, a scenario that is relevant to a project or an organization, where you would need to understand the situation that is given in that scenario, and you would need to identify the answer that would best solve the problem given in that scenario. And there can be questions related to lists or groupings as well. So where PMI will be testing your knowledge on groupings of activities, of tools, of tasks, or anything which is defined in the PMBOK. So for example, there are different types of contracts that are defined in project procurement management. So you would get a list of contract types as an answer for the different types of contracts related question, and then you would see an answer which is not relevant, where you need to figure out which is not relevant. So these are the 4 main types of questions that you would see in the PMP exam. So this is a rough distribution of questions based on the process group. So the PMBOK is defined mainly based on project management process groups. There are 5 main process groups that are in PMBOK, which is project initiation, planning, execution, monitoring and controlling, and project closing. A project manager would normally get involved in planning, execution, and monitoring and controlling, and he would be spending majority of his time during the lifetime of the project for these particular process group areas. So in the exam also, a higher weightage is given for questions from these particular process group areas. So from initiation, you might see that 13%, roughly about 13% of the questions are from initiation, 24% from planning, 30% from execution, roughly about 25% from monitoring and controlling, and about 8% from the project closing process group area. Preparing for the exam is really important. one thing that you need to make sure is that once you have started filling in the application form, make sure that you have adequate time in order to prepare for the exam. So preparation itself would roughly take about 6 to 8 months time period, where you would need to go through the classroom sessions and the study sessions that are required. You need to obtain the PDUs where you need to report them in your application form. Make sure that you read the PMBOK guide at least twice, and buy a study guide or any online materials as required, and make sure that you spend at least 1 hour per day going through these materials and try to understand whatever concepts that are defined in the PMBOK guide along with some examples, and participate in study groups or group discussions organized by maybe by your chapter, the PMI local chapter. And the most important way of preparing for the PMP exam is to do practice questions. So do at least 1,500 to 2,000 practice questions, which would be really helpful for you when it comes to the actual examination time. So a brief introduction to the PMBOK guide. The PMBOK guide is the globally recognized standard for the practice of project management. The current version of the PMBOK guide is version 6. And the version 6 comes with two main areas, part 1 and part 2, 19 chapters in total. 13 chapters initially, where it talks about the different knowledge areas, project management knowledge areas, where there are 10 key knowledge areas that are defined in the PMBOK. And then the second part would be on the five process groups. And the PMBOK guide defines the project management process groups, the project management knowledge areas, the associated tasks, techniques, activities, and the skills that are required by a project manager in order to effectively execute a project. The primary purpose of the project management guide, project management body of knowledge guide, is to define the profession of project management. And it is the baseline which practitioners can use in order to plan out the activities, execute the activities, control the activities, as well as identify areas for improving whatever tasks that they are performing. And the PMBOK guide also defines the skills and knowledge that a project manager should be able to apply in his day-to-day tasks as a project manager. Knowledge areas in project management. So like I said, there are 10 main knowledge areas. A knowledge area defines what a project management practitioner needs to understand and the task that a project management practitioner must be able to perform. And then these knowledge areas can be performed iteratively. It does not need to go in sequence. And it is not intended to define any phases or milestones in a project. It can, all these tasks defined in the knowledge areas can happen iteratively, simultaneously, and even multiple times. And whatever tasks which the project manager feels relevant for a given time or a context can be performed at any given point in time. So these are the 10 main knowledge areas defined in PMBOK guide version 6. Integration management, scope management, schedule management, cost management, quality management, resource management, communications management, risk management, procurement management, and stakeholder management. We'll be looking at these knowledge areas at a high level in the coming slides. So one thing to remember is that the project manager needs to focus on the triple constraints of a project. The triple constraints are scope, time, and cost. And all these, the management of scope, time, and cost must be done while maintaining the quality of the project and the product. So these knowledge areas will define how a project manager should manage the project during the lifetime of the project while maintaining the triple constraints. So the first knowledge area that we would be looking at is project integration management. Project integration management actually brings all activities that a project manager would perform during the lifetime of a project, all together. So it unifies or consolidates all the activities that a project manager would perform during the lifetime of a project. So integration includes characteristics of unification, consolidation, communication, and interrelationship in the context of project management. And during integration management, the project manager should focus on how the resources should be identified, how the resources should be allocated, how the resources should be assigned to projects, how the resources and their time can be better managed, how balancing of competing demands can happen, how the project manager can identify different approaches that he can take in terms of managing the project. And during integration management, the project manager would also identify the configuration management process and the version controlling process for different artifacts or deliverables of the project. And then he would determine how he should tailor the activities or processes that are involved in project management so that the project can be executed in a proper manner. The next knowledge area that we will be looking at is project scope management. The scope of a project defines the boundary of the project. So the scope, there are two main types of scope in terms of project scope and the product scope. The project scope mainly focuses on the triple constraints: time, cost, quality, and then the scope of project. So the product scope mainly focuses on the solution or the product, service, or the result that a project is organized for. So in scope management, the project manager should identify all the tasks or all the work that needs to be performed in order to complete the project successfully. So the scope management involves identifying the scope, managing the scope, making sure that the scope of the project is controlled, and making sure that there is no scope creep in the project. The third knowledge area is project schedule management. This includes all the processes that are required to manage the timely completion of the project. So the project, as I mentioned earlier, is a unique endeavor with a timeline in order to achieve a specific objective. So this time, defining the timeline would be the main objective of project schedule management. So during schedule management, the project manager would utilize the work breakdown structure that is defined during scope management. Using that work breakdown structure, he would identify the tasks and then the effort that is required for each work package or activity, and then use that time in order to come up with a detailed plan on how the task would be performed, in which sequence, and then identify the results that can be generated through that plan. Project cost management is the next knowledge area. This process involves identifying, planning, estimating, budgeting, financing, funding, managing, and controlling all the costs that are related to a project. So all the resources that are utilized in the project, may it be human or non-human, will involve a cost. So executing tasks will involve a cost. There will be direct costs and indirect costs that are applicable for projects. So it is important for project managers to identify all these cost elements, plan for those cost elements, and then create forecasts or create budgets for the project, and then make sure that those particular budgets are applied for tasks and then monitored and controlled during the lifetime of the project. Project quality management involves ensuring that the project and the product is delivered is of high quality. So quality management involves quality planning, quality assurance, and quality control. The project manager also needs to make sure that there is continuous improvement in terms of project as well as product quality. Project risk management involves identifying the right resources that are required for the project, and to make sure that you get the resources at the right time and at the right place. So like I mentioned earlier, project resources can be human or non-human, and resource management will involve all the processes that are required to identify, acquire, and manage the resources required for successful completion of the project. Project communications management is another important knowledge area. So communication is key for project success, and this communication can happen between two or many stakeholders involved in a project. So communication management involves all the processes that are necessary to ensure that the information needs of the project and its stakeholders are met, and to make sure that a proper exchange of information happens between the different stakeholders of the project. So communications management involves two parts: coming up with a strategy, coming up with a communication strategy, and coming up with a plan on how to communicate with different stakeholders. And then the second aspect is of executing this particular plan and to make sure that this communication plan is adhered to properly. The main objective of communication is to make sure that proper relationships are created and maintained among the main stakeholders of the project in order to make sure that the project is completed successfully. Every project will involve uncertain events, and this uncertainty will have a positive or negative impact on the project. So uncertain events that can have a positive or negative impact on a project is called a risk. And this risk will have a probability of occurrence and an impact on the project if that particular risk occurs. So project risk management involves identifying all these risks, planning for these risks, planning a strategy in order to meet this risk, identifying how to respond to such a risk, and then how to implement and monitor responses that are identified to manage that risk. So in risk management, it is important for the project manager to identify strategies which will enhance or improve the probability of a positive risk happening and increase the impact of such a positive risk. And then also to identify strategies in order to decrease the probability of a negative risk happening, and then reducing the impact of a negative risk as well. Is project procurement management. There will be a lot of items, or there will be a lot of services, products that will need to be obtained from third-party entities during the lifetime of a project. So the organization which is implementing the project will not have all the resources, equipment, or anything that is required to execute the project. They would need to seek for additional resources from outside. So identifying these resources and then procuring these resources, acquiring these resources from outside, creating contracts, maintaining these contracts with those third party elements is part of project procurement management. So project procurement management and control involves processes that are required to develop and administer agreements such as contracts, purchase orders, memoranda of understanding, or internal service level agreements in order to manage that the project procurement. The last knowledge area is project stakeholder management. So every project will have a lot of stakeholders that are involved in a project, and these stakeholders will have an interest and an impact that they would make on the project and the different activities that are performed in the project. So in stakeholder management, the project manager must identify all the stakeholders, identify communication strategies for all these stakeholders, identify the interest and impact level of these stakeholders, and then devise strategies to manage the interests of these stakeholders. Now we are come to the last part of today's session. We'll be looking at the live virtual classroom sessions that are conducted by Knowledgehut. So live virtual classroom sessions, or we call them LVC sessions, allow aspirants to participate in training sessions at their own convenience, at a convenient time or a place. So this live classroom sessions is more suitable for professionals who have a busy schedule, who have a busy working schedule. They can decide on where they want to do this particular training session and when they want to do it. And you can easily access the live virtual classroom sessions from your home. All you need is an internet speed of a minimum of 1 Mbps. And the classroom sessions are flexible timelines. So wherever you are in the world, based on your geographical location, you can select the most suitable time for you and then attend the session. So first of all, what you need to do is you need to enroll for a live virtual classroom session as a participant. Once you enroll, once you select the particular course that you want to follow, and once you make the payment, you will get a link which you can use to join these particular sessions. So once you click on the session, you would access to the virtual learning platform. It is advisable that you attend the session at least 10 minutes before the session to make sure that the tool is working properly and to make sure that your headset and the microphone is working properly. And like with this particular webinar session, there will be a trainer who would take you through the classroom materials. There will be PPT or any other training materials that would be shown on your screen, and you can follow those materials while the trainer talks you through that. So these live virtual classroom sessions are also a methodology that you can follow to obtain the PDUs that you require to complete your application form. So during the live virtual classroom sessions, there are a lot of ways that you can collaborate with the trainer. It is perfectly fine to interrupt the trainer at any given point in time. You can we'll look at the different features that are provided by the platform in the coming slides. So you can chat with the trainer, you can directly talk to the trainer or post comments or questions, and you can make this session as interactive as possible. Once the session is done, you will have access to the recordings from the session at no extra cost. After the training as well, you can communicate with the trainer at your leisure. And your feedback about the session is always important for us. So you'll be getting online feedback forms to comment on the training sessions. So this is a look at the platform, and we'll be looking at a few features of this of our learning platform in the coming slide. So the first option that you can use to collaborate is to use this setup. So on the training platform, you would see the different panelists and the trainer's name on the right hand side of your screen. So you can select your trainer if you want to chat with him, and then select the chat option. Using this chat option, you can directly communicate with the trainer, ask questions and clarify doubts then and there. The trainer will answer your questions online, or he can even type the answer through the chat. And if you want to interrupt your trainer and ask a question while the training is going on, you can do that as well. So in order to stop the trainer, you just need to raise your hand using this raise hand option. So this raising the hand will unmute you, where you can ask the question from your trainer. You can seek permission and then ask questions and get the clarifications then and there. So once you have asked the question, it is strongly advised that you lower your hand again. So the learning platform also provides a Q&A option, where you can use this particular feature to type in whatever question that you have. If you have questions which require more clarification, and if you, in your question itself, if you want to add the examples and clarifications and so on, you can use this Q&A option. We will again send a message to the trainer in text format. The trainer can decide to answer then and there, or he and answer your question. So timings for the session. Normally there'll be two training slots of 4 hours duration per day. The first session will be from 6 a.m. to 10 a.m. and the second session will be from 7:30 p.m. to 11:30 p.m. So you can join any session which is of convenience to you, but make sure that once you join a particular session that you follow that particular time period only. There will not be a facility for you to change your session preference while the training is going on. That's all that I want to cover about the PMP certification, the examination, the application process, and how you need to prepare for the exam. Please do reach out to me if you have any questions. I'll be glad to respond to any queries that you have. You can communicate with me through LinkedIn, via email, Twitter, or Skype. Here are the details. So, looking forward to hearing from you. Thank you very much, and I'll soon meet you again in my next webinar session. Thanks a lot.